Hey everyone, welcome to How Success Happens. I'm Dan Bova here at Entrepreneur, and with me today is a guest who calls himself a professional talker. His resume is littered with iconic comedy creations and performances, stuff like Mr. Show, Arrested Development, Grammy-nominated specials. He hosts a podcast called Senses Working Overtime with David Cross, and this fall, he's hitting the road with his new comedy tour, David Cross, The End of the Beginning of the End. Rolls right off the tongue, but he's here right now. He's bearded in the face of a national heat wave. He's fearless, my friends, David Cross. Well, as that wall and my introduction show, you're quite a busy guy. You've done a lot and you continue to do a lot. And so kind of my first question is, when you reach a level of success and what I'm guessing is some amount of financial stability, why do you keep doing things?
Well, I mean, I'm lucky enough to love what I do. You know, a lot of people can't really say that. And you know, I'll probably work. The idea of retiring is strange to me. And, and sometimes, let's be fair, Hollywood decides to retire me at stretches without informing me. But I will most likely be doing what I am doing until I physically or mentally can't anymore. And, you know, and stand-up is just a matter of getting myself to room and talking for a while and then eventually going out on tour, which is a pain in the ass. It can be kind of grueling, as you might imagine, just life on the road. But I love it, and I'll keep doing it.
When you're on the road, and specifically, just to jump ahead, I guess, so David Cross, Worst Daddy in the World is your special that's currently on YouTube, which is hilarious. And you take a couple of shots at some places in the country that you will soon be touring in. What do you like kind of setting up that you're going into battle? I mean, assuming the people there are going to be your fans, but what's that like? That approach?
Yeah, well, those people know that the place they live sucks. I mean, it's not a mystery. You know, there aren't. You know, they do. And, you know, sucks is relative. Everything is, there's some people that just absolutely hate New York, and I don't feel that way. And there are some people that, you know, see nothing, you know, valuable about Houston. And I'm one of those people. So, you know, there's different strokes for different folks. And some people like Phoenix. Dan, I mean, when was the last time you went to Phoenix? Because I was there recently.
Yeah.
And I go there. I have really fun shows. But those people aren't under the impression that they're not. They're like, yeah, we get it. We know this place sucks. And, you know, I have to be here for school. I have to be here for work or whatever. My family's here. I'm taking care of my mom, whatever. But, you know, and I don't know, a third of this country lives in a place where they are required by city ordinance to put misters out of misting, you know, cooling water. Otherwise, half of the citizenry will die. And like, why would, and people choose to live? Okay. All right.
I was going to say, my memory of Phoenix is it being like 120 degrees. Being assured it was a dry heat, and then going to brunch, and there was many people with pistols just right on their belts as we were eating our eggs. So that
because sometimes, you know, they've heard it's just science that the heat can kill you. And look, it's a line of defense. You bring your gun and you kill anything that might kill you. So you shoot up the heat and it makes things better. It's a wonderful way to live.
Wow, that's, I never thought of it that way, but that is smart. So when you're going into this show, or, you know, when you put together Worst Daddy in the World, Do you go into it with like, this is the theme that I want to talk about, or you kind of find it as you're going?
Yeah, you find it. Because I start, like most comics, I'm putting, once you do a special and your stuff's out there, unfortunately, and stand-up's the only place where this exists in the arts, you know, you're done. That material is done. You burned it. You got to start fresh every single time. So, you know, once the special airs, I got to do new stuff. And there's always, just because of the nature of how I do what I do, I'm very, you know, I riff a lot and bits will expand and I write on stage. So, you know, the stuff I'm doing at the end of the tour is different than the beginning. And then the show expands, so I got to cut some because I don't want to be up there for 2 hours. So I'll always have like, and I did this time, like, I'd say 20 minutes of stuff that I haven't done yet that just didn't make it into the last special or even the latter half of the last tour because I had to drop stuff. So I'm starting with something. It's like a sourdough batch.
Right.
I've always got 20 minutes of stuff to work on. And then I just go up and I do shows. I do them here in New York called Shooting the Shit, Seeing What Sticks. And I record them all and I just riff. And the first, you know, six, give or take, are like, what the fuck was that? You know? But then eventually it starts filling out. And also personal things happen. You know, I have this whole, I think it's going to be the opening bit, but this whole bit that is relatively new. It happened, I don't know, 4 or 5 months ago, maybe. And that's a whole story that wasn't there before, but that's a thing that happened to, or a thing that I experienced. And when it was happening, it was like, oh my God, I can't wait to do this on stage. and it's been really fun to do. I can't really go into it. I'll give it away. But,
I was curious about that. Like when something, I don't know what happened, but I'm assuming it wasn't like a great thing in the moment that was happening.
It was awkward. I wouldn't say it was great or not great. And that will be through the eyes of the beholder. I think some people would go, that's awesome. And some people go, ew. It was just awkward and unexpected.
So when something awkward or bad happens to you, you know, are you in the back of your mind always thinking like, oh, this is awesome, I can use this, even though in the moment?
Yeah, I don't, you know, whether it's like really embedded subconsciously or whether it's right there while it's happening.
Yeah.
And, you know, in whatever, I might be scared on the outside or uncomfortable or whatever, but inside, there's a little version of me going, yay!
That's awesome. So, you know, that notion of going up there with a half-baked or not baked idea at all sounds terrifying. Most people are terrified to speak in front of people, period. And you've talked about, you know, having anxiety in your life. Mm. And how do those two, why are you doing this to yourself? Or does it actually make you feel less anxious when you're on stage now?
Well, it's not that kind of anxiety. It's the anxiety I have is how do you put it in words? But it's like this feeling that I am struggling to control of that. And it's not logical. And it's why because I used to be on medication and then I stopped and I would go back and forth and back and forth. And then I started acting this way again once my daughter started going to school. And I was just kind of manic and I know it's crazy. And they're like, we got to get out, got to get, you got to brush your teeth, got to go. And I'm in my head, I'm going, fucking chill, dude, it's fine. And I get weird when we're playing video games, I'm trying to teach her something and I can't, you don't understand. It's embarrassing, but I mean, it's a thing. And the anxiety is, if I don't check it, it can pretty easily slip into nihilism too. And I can't afford that with a kid and I don't, And it's, so it's, it, the anxiety for me is just like, and it's, again, it's not logical. Like, it's fine if we're 5 minutes late, it's fine.
Yeah.
You know, but I would just get, it started again when my, again, when I was getting my daughter, she started going to school, and like, I was just like, you know, even before I had a kid, and my wife and I have a place, upstate, and, you know, I've had it since before I met her, like 17 years now. And like me leaving, there's no fucking time limit at all. It's the only thing is like, let's not hit traffic, right? That's kind of it. But whether you leave at 11 or 11:30 or noon or 12:30, it doesn't matter. And I'm that last day, I'm running around going, well, no, we're not fucking getting in the car until this plate is clean. You know, what? You know, just
right.
So it's a weird, it's,
yeah.
It's, so it has really nothing to do with the thing about going on stage.
Got it. And you know, I'm laughing because I'm commiserating, and I have two kids that they're older now, but you know, absolutely losing my mind because you won't put your shoes on and we're going to be late to third grade. Like,
I know.
Who cares?
I know.
You can miss a week and it doesn't matter. Like, what's yeah. the, yeah.
I know. It's like I was noticing my behavior and really not happy with it. And then got back. I'm on the lowest dosage of what I used to be on, at quite a high dosage. And it's great. It evens me out. I don't get into that, and I'm able to go to myself, you know, just chill out, take a step back. It's all right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Good. Calm down, you know? And, but yeah, the like putting all that energy and that shit onto a kid, it's like, you know, you've already done this weird thing by setting an alarm clock for a 5-year-old. Like, what are you why are we waking kids up at 5 years old going, hey, get up, why? You have to eat. What? hurry, eat. You know, she's like 4, whatever pre-K is.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, like 4 years old, hurry, get, wake up. But I was sleeping. No, you gotta get up and eat. Why do I have to eat? So you don't get hungry later. What's happening? Nothing yet. You're gonna go play with the colors. Now, what? You woke me up to make me eat so I could play with colors? Yeah, come on. It's such a strange thing.
And then now you gotta go to bed. Go to bed. That's so great. So you've got this show that's coming up, which at Central Park, August 8th. Mm-hmm. David Cross and his super pals, Bob Odenkirk, Sarah Silverman, Fred Armisen, and many others. So when you're putting together a show like that, when you call your super friends or your super pals, are you like telling them this is what the show's going to be? Or are you saying, here's 20 minutes, do whatever you want with it? Like, how does that
all come? I mean, it depends on what the show is, but yeah, pretty much with this one. And look, I will say this now, I guarantee one or two of these folks will flake. It always happens. Always. I shouldn't say flake. That's, you know, like something, it's such a kind of non-committal thing. It's not like we've taken the show on the road, like, hey, and I reach out and people want to do it, but there's always something comes up. That will happen. Always does. It happened the last time I was in New York, I did 2 nights at the Irving Plaza and said, like, there are going to be special guests because, you know, I'm home and all my friends are here. and two of them, you know, are like, and again, valid reasons, but like, oh, yeah, I can't do the show. They're like, okay. So that will, I guarantee it, that will happen. That's sort of the nature of this thing, you know.
Yeah.
If it was a benefit, I could guilt them.
Yeah.
It's, you know, roughly 2 hours. It'll be fun. It'll be nice outdoors, big, cool, prestigious stage and event. And, we're just going to have fun. The lineup is pretty killer. I mean, it's, you know, even if people drop out, it's still like a killer show.
So I just finished reading this book that you were quoted. Yeah, can you?
That's great, man. How long you been working on that?
It was a long book. Meet Me in the Bathroom. And you're quoted extensively in that. So a couple of things. For first, you're obviously a huge figure in the alternative comedy scene of the 90s. And then according with this book, you know, you were right there in the middle of this kind of rebirth of rock in New York in the 2000s. So first, are you in fact the Forrest Gump of cool things? Meaning you're kind of always seem to be there when something interesting is happening. But what I'm wondering is when you're in the middle of these seminal cultural moments, do you know you are, or it's just like you're out, you're having fun, and then 10 years later it's like, wow, that was like an era?
A little of both, really. I mean, you know, as far as like the comedy thing, that we were aware that what we were all doing was kind of special. And you know, none of us called it alternative comedy. That was some journalist from LA Weekly, I believe, came up with that thing. We were just doing shows with each other for each other, and that it wasn't all the other stuff came after that. You know, that was just, it was just like, you know, very few people were like, I've got to be famous. How am I going to be famous? And, you know, we were just doing what we've always done, and wherever we came from, eventually we, a large number migrated to Hollywood, but, you know, whether the scene was Boston, Chicago, San Francisco, wherever, you know, people were doing their thing, and we were just continuing that. And then we kind of, we were aware of, you know, the kind of, oh, we're the cool kids of the scene, you know, and what we were doing was really special for sure. And there's a lot of talented people in that. And then as far as I've always been a part of the music scene wherever I live, whether it was Atlanta or Boston, and that kind of creative, there's a woven kind of symbiosis between comedy and music, and there has been for a long time. And there are a lot of, you know, musicians who are like, man, I can't believe you do what you do. That's crazy. I could never do that. And then comics who would say the same thing to music, like, man, that's fucking ballsy and cool, and I could never do that, you know. And there's an appreciation and admiration for, you know, each other in those groups, and everybody hangs out. It's just a natural thing. And if you're especially in a, you know, a packed, very dense and densely populated with artistic types in comedy and music, like in the East Village, Lower East Side, in the aughts, you know, I mean, everybody just, you couldn't help it. You knew everybody. We all lived in the same buildings. We went to the same places, and we did each other's shows and stuff like that. And, you know, as far as that thing, I think we were all just having fun. So it wasn't like, but also music stars are way bigger and busier than comedy, you know, outside of like the top 10 comedians, you know, the top 1,000 cool bands, you kind of know them, you know what I mean? You don't the 680th cool comedian, but you do know who the band is, you know. And, you know, it was just, so you're aware of it that way, but you're just having fun. It's not.
Yeah. The book, I love the book just because, like, I was sort of around in that time. I didn't live in your building, so, you know, what are you going to do? But
you missed out.
I did wonder, you know, you and other people, like, tell these amazing stories. Like, how the hell do you remember anything? Like, a lot of those stories happen at, like, 4 o'clock in the morning. I'm guessing not entirely sober. How do you recall that stuff?
I'll be honest. I remember vaguely doing the interviews for it. But when it came out, I skimmed, went to pages that I'm in, and it's all, you know, what I read was stuff about, and I was fucked up and I did this thing. And then we broke into this place and we, whatever the thing is. And I'll be honest with you, I was a little embarrassed and, like I regretted that that's, you know, I mean, I had a great time. It was fun, but like all the stories, and maybe there's some, I mean, I'm sure there's some, I just glanced at a couple of them. I would hope that there are some that aren't just like, and then we got fucked up and we went here and then we did drugs and then we did, you know, whatever. And, but that's mostly what I saw. So I just put it down and I was a little ashamed.
Don't be ashamed. No, it's great. There's a lot more to it than being, there are a lot of, we were so fucked up, but there's a lot of other stuff.
And we were. You may be fucked up or one may be fucked up, but it doesn't mean you don't remember.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, those are some of your, those are potentially some of one's, you know, greatest memories or specific memories.
So you've been in a number, so speaking of this group of creative people that you're always around, this is probably a very dumb question, but, you know, you've been in so many great things with so many great actors, and I always wonder, like, are you able to watch Ozark and, like, worry that Jason Bateman's character is in trouble? Or, like, can you only see Jason Bateman and never lose yourself in that?
No, I could totally lose. I mean, I watched Better Call Saul, you know, to the end and watched, you know, the same way everybody did, where you're like, what's going to happen? What's going to happen? And, oh my God, I hope Gene doesn't get discovered, you know, I could totally do that. Yeah.
So has your daughter seen the Chipmunks and has she forgiven you for being such a dick to them?
She sort of has seen it, but, it was kind of, they were, scrolling. My sister was here. I think my wife and I were away and my sister was up here, taking care of her and scrolling through. And I happened to, there was like a clip of it, whatever, what the on TV was playing. And then she's like, hey, that's, you know, that's daddy. And then that was about all the interest she showed, which I'm thrilled with. And, seriously. And, and she's heard my voice, but never made the connection. Like she was a big Megamind fan, probably watched Megamind five times. She watched Kung Fu Panda a bunch, you know, when she was younger. I did stuff on shows just cause she was watching. So I'm on Bubble Guppies and a bunch of kids things. And,
oh, that's cool.
And so she never made the connection. So right. Maybe when she's older, I don't know, but it's not like I'm going to show it to her, or sit her down and go, hey kiddo, it's about time I showed you what daddy does. So that it hasn't been like that.
Yeah. Or sneak up behind her and speak in one of those voices and see if she's like, how the hell are you getting? So when you are, you know, going to have a show, like, I don't know, say you're going to do something tonight, like, do you just show up and walk up on stage? Do you need like some time in a bubble to like, to decompress? Like what's your, do you have a ritual?
Well, I helicopter into every one of my shows, and then I descend or ascend on the stage, depending on how it's built, in a screen of fire, basically. It's a sheet of fire. It's not real fire, obviously, or I'd catch on fire, but
obviously.
And then, you know, I have my gold suit on and I'm painted gold head to toe. Fanfare for the Common Man, Aaron Copland will play. I'll let it play in its entirety. It's a long piece. And then I say hi. And then I say, if you could give me a minute. And then I go backstage for an hour and take a cold plunge. I literally just walk. I will walk or ride my bike to these shows here in Brooklyn. And I just, actually, you know what? No, that's not exactly true. Cause what I'll do is I'll go, each place I perform at, and I've been doing this for years now. There's a bar that I will go to within like five blocks, and I will go early and get all my notes. And I have a transcript. Here's one of them right here, you know, of that transcript of my tape set. And I'll go over things. I'll highlight stuff. I'll have done this before I do it, but little things that I want to remember that I riffed last time. Oh, that's a good point. I should do this after this. And I'll go, I'll have a beer and I'll just sit and I'll spend, you know, 20, 25 minutes just going over all that stuff, going, you know, figuring out my order. And then I'll continue on to the club and I'll just pretty much go like right before, you know, everybody's in, and I go in with 5 minutes left and then I settle in and I start the show.
Do you, so I know your daughter is going to school now. Do you have you talk a little bit about this in your show, but like, do you have any trepidation about like, you know, talking about like a parent you met at the playground and knowing them?
Yeah. I mean, the guy that I describe in, The Worst Daddy in the World, where I talk about the Brooklyn hipster parents, it's an amalgam of a bunch of guys, but it's really this one guy who is super annoying. And and it's also, but as I say, it's me being judgmental. It's me. I believe I'm right, but it is, you know, it's just, and, you know, you're talking about my response, which is not particularly pleasant. I mean, it's I'm a bit of a curmudgeon, you know, and I don't like small talk. I never did. And, you know, it's just the same trite shit over and over again, the same dumb questions. But there is one guy, but I try to dress it up enough so it could, and it's also Brooklyn. It could be one of a million guys. The guy I describe is a guy I'm picturing in my head. I know who he is, but he's also bits and pieces of every other guy. So he'll never know it's him if he heard the bit, or it could be literally 500 guys hearing the bit going, "Hey, he's talking about me."
Well, all I could say is if your daughter loves playing sports, get ready for some primo small talk for over like a 4-hour Little League game. So just be ready for that.
Yeah.
Among your peers or just people that you've met, this is probably a tough question, but who's like the person that's just naturally the funniest person you know that just cracks, intentionally or not, just makes you laugh?
Well, oh man, there's so many. I mean, I mean, my wife's very, very funny. One of my best friends growing up, who's now in LA, who did the music for Mr. Show and a bunch of scored some shows that I did. And, he's one of the funniest guys I know, Mark Rivers. And he writes for, he does music for, Big Mouth. Is that the name of the Nick?
Oh yeah.
He does that. And he was on Parks and Recs. He's pretty ensconced in that business. He's very funny. There's a manager of comedians named Dave Rath, who's very, very funny.
I know him.
Okay. And of course, Bob Odenkirk and John Benjamin and, you know, and just people who will have me, you know, crying, laughing.
Right. And is there anyone who is just like, wow, this is a weird person, like very funny, very talented, but my God, they are strange.
Oh yeah. There's more of those than, yeah. I mean, there's a lot of, you know, or at least weird to me. I'm not going to name names.
Come on. Damn it. Damn it. Well, so people watching this is on Entrepreneurs Podcast Network. So maybe they're looking to get into comedy or writing. Maybe they're not. But
why would you go on the entrepreneur website to get into comedy?
Well, so this actually, I did want to ask you about this because what's interesting about what you do or can do is, like, as you said, you know, you'll make movies, you make TV shows, but then you could just make your own thing. Mm-hmm. You could just, like, create you are a business. And you could just, you know, decide I'm going to do a show and I'm going to go on tour. So you could, like, create your own livelihood. So I guess what my question is, for people who are looking to do something, and they feel stuck, like, has there anything ever helped you along the way to, like, get you unstuck when you felt like, this isn't working out or I'm not liking this anymore?
You mean creatively, like
creatively, or even just like, you know, ugh, I don't feel like going on the road cause this is such a slog, but
you feel like that from show to show. You're just like, I'm really tired. We were out last night till 2 a.m. and then we had to get up and go to, Spokane Airport and make a connecting flight to Oklahoma City, you know, and you don't get in till late. And all I've been eating is, you know, Fritos. And,
right.
I mean, that's just professionalism. You just have to figure out how to get yourself, whether it's doing a bunch of push-ups or, you know, whatever the thing is, I'm one thing I pride myself in is, you know, I give 100% every time I'm up there, and I'm always, even if the crowd sucks, which doesn't really happen that much anymore, but I always imagine, and I'm being literal about this, like a 16-year-old kid in the upper in the balcony, at the back of the balcony, who this is his first comedy show and he wants to do stand up, he or she, whoever. And I want to do that show for that kid. Cause I was that kid at that point. I feel a really strong responsibility to the audience who, you know, carved out time to come see me and, you know, bought tickets and got a babysitter and had a park for $25 or whatever. So I make myself get there. And as far as, like, you know, I'll go, going out on tour and doing shows is, serves two purposes. One is it's how I earn a living, you know, and my wife loves Amazon, loves it, and loves the clicky part when you click the thing and then the box comes the next day, and she loves that shit. And you know, somebody's got to pay for the clicks, the clicky things, and the boxes that come. When you get like three or four of the same kind of thing and then, oh my God, I've got four different mandolins. I need a mandolin holder. Do they make mandolin holders? Click, 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 click. Oh, they do make mandolin holders. And so she'll get a holder for the mandolins in the kitchen. And then you've got too many mandolin holders, so there's a grand mandolin holder. I do that to make money, and but also it's a creative outlet, and I have to do something. So if I'm not doing my own show or acting or writing, then that's the thing that's a little bit of all that.
That's awesome. We'll jump into some audience questions in one second, but I did want to ask you, you know, is your approach when you're kind of like a hired gun on a TV show appearance, like, does that change things much for you versus something that you've written? I mean, obviously you didn't write it, but like, does your approach change if I'm saying words someone else wrote?
No, not really. I mean, I the reason I would take the part is, I mean, because I'm interested in doing it, and whether it's the kind of the project as a whole, and I want to be a part of that project, or I'm kind of challenging myself to do something that's a little out of my comfort zone or whatever. But my approach, you know, I'm servicing the writer and the director, and that's, I guess, a little different than servicing myself or a writing or producing partner. But you know, you want to try to give them what the reason they hired you, you know. And yeah. I always assume that I'm hired because I improvise a lot, and I always try to clear that. And what I've been doing for, you know, decades now is like, I'll give you the written version. I'll give you that as cleanly and as strongly as I can give you. And then we'll play around and we'll see what comes up, use whatever you know, use it or don't. Yeah. But I assume a lot of time that's why I'm hired.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
So I recently heard an interview with Ron Howard where he said he would commit to a new season of Arrested Development if everyone would commit to it. So putting you on the spot, will you commit?
I don't think it's a good idea. I just don't. And there's no – and Jessica's not with us anymore, so I don't know how you do it without Lucille.
Right.
And, I mean – you know, ideally we would have stopped after season 4.
Okay.
I mean, I loved it and I still love it. And I think it's just great. And I'm so lucky to have been given that opportunity. And it was, you know, I love those guys, but I don't think we should do any more.
All right. Well, I can understand that, but my son, who's in college, went as you, as Tobias, as a Blue Man Group member last Halloween. So sure. It lives on. It lives on.
Yeah.
Brad, did you want to jump in here?
Well, I had a quick one around the kind of entrepreneur angle. You know, you are your own product. You are your own business. And that's right. That's kind of an interesting circumstance that you find yourself in. Was there a moment where you realized that you were this product that you had to sell and you wanted to grow the business of you? I understand like wanting success and, but like,
well, no, I'm a terrible businessman in that definition because I'm not comfortable with, to the degree that a lot of these successful comics are of promoting self-promotion. I don't like it. It's a little unseemly to me. It doesn't come naturally. It makes me feel a little gross. You know, I don't have a heavy social media thing. I don't do TikToks, and I have to get talked into posting little videos about, hey guys, I'm coming out to, and I'll do it and it's fine. And I truly understand the value of it, but I'm not, I think I could be now and could have been much more successful if I focused on that and self-promotion. And there's some people who are really good at it, you know, and that's just not my thing. I don't like it.
Right. Okay. Love it. Yeah. But luckily it all worked out anyway. So that's good.
Yeah. So what do you say? Should we get to some of the reader questions, Brad?
Let's do it. We have our first question submitted on video from Greg M.
David Cross, I'm a huge fan of your comedy and your beard. I'm so jealous. You've had successes. You've had things that weren't produced or maybe didn't turn out the way that you wanted. What's your reaction to criticism? Whose criticism do you trust, not trust? I've heard you on stage talk about being judgmental. Does anyone's voice matter but your own? Should anyone's voice matter but your own? Your voice matters to me. I'm listening.
That's a good question. I like that question. I would say specifically my wife and Bob Odenkirk and there are a handful of people, John Benjamin, like when they give me a compliment, I know it's not bullshit. And I know it comes from a intellectual place. There's some people that like my stuff way too much. And there's some people that just hate my stuff. And I try to not listen to those those extremes. I think it's important to listen to valid criticism. Like, I may disagree, I may not like it, but I can understand the point. You know, if it's not something like you're offensive or you shouldn't talk about that or those things aren't really criticisms anyway. But if somebody has like a critical take on a bit in which I don't necessarily agree with them, but I can see their point and where they're coming from and they've articulated that, then yeah, that's a criticism I'll take. And I can acknowledge it, whether I choose to do anything about it. That's a different story. Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. But the people that like I can do no wrong, or the people that I can do no right, I'm not going to really pay attention to that.
Okay, so second question. This was written in from Hank. What is a deep cut Mr. Show sketch that you love that most people don't mention or ever think about?
Oh shit. Well, gosh. I mean, here's the thing. Most people are more familiar with Mr. Show than I am. I just, only because we just sort of stopped.
Yeah.
You know, we were so part of it that you just got some distance and I just haven't. Let me think. Maybe Shampoo. That's one that never really gets mentioned. That's an early, early one. That was based on a real thing. That's pretty fun. We've done that live too. It's fun to do. One of my favorite sketches was always prenatal pageants, which is got so many great ideas and so many, and Bob, the performances in that one are just fantastic, and Bob's great, and Jill and Sarah Thayer, everybody is even down to John Ennis, who doesn't have a line but just makes a goofy face when he's introduced as a child. I mean, everybody, it's just across the board, I really am proud of that sketch. One of those.
One of those. Okay. My son, who I mentioned is a big fan of yours, sent me the Dalai Lama one, where then you go up against the rich kids from the fat kid camp. I did not recall that one, but that was amazing.
Yeah.
When you guys are writing these sketches, is it like people sitting at laptops, like writing this insanity, or you like yelling things out? Like, what was the writer's room like?
It was both. I mean, it was, Bob and I would meet for a month before the rest of the writers came in, and we would just really informally talk about things that we saw in the news or whatever. And then if a sketch idea occurred to us, and then we would just really start by talking and then we'd write a bunch of stuff and then invite the writers, and the writers would have, you know, naturally had a bunch of ideas with them. And we would have, I think it was Wednesdays were pitch days, and we would pitch. And Bob was very democratic and wouldn't immediately dismiss an idea, would try hopefully we wouldn't spend too much time. Sometimes you'd have to go, there's nothing there, let's move on. But was really good about, let's find the kernel in here, if there is a kernel, and maybe we have to completely alter the idea. But And sometimes, you know, during a pitch, you're just, you know, riffing within while you're, in fact, there's a great example, the House of the Future or something like that. It's the Monoku house sketch where the furniture talks and for blind people, right? For something like that. So Jay Johnston wrote that sketch and it was dying. I mean, it was just no laughs, nothing. And it was just sitting there and we're all reading it and it's, and you feel it. You feel when this sketch is not, I mean, this had nothing. And then I don't know what made me do this or if it was just whatever, because it's a little disrespectful, but fuck it. It was my show. But I started reading it in this really weird way. And then Bob picked up on it. And then we all started doing that. And then that became, well, oh, wait, it is funny now. It was one of those things where you just, there it is. It was like on paper, it wasn't working at all. And then we just sort of found this thing, you know, intuitively that made it work. And then, you know, there was like a rewrite and pitching. And also the one you mentioned, the monk thing, I believe that was Scott Aukerman and BJ Porter who wrote that. It was like two different ideas. One was the fat kid camp trope movie thing. And then there was the Dalai Lama thing, which I think might have been Bob's idea about a Dalai Lama. The next Dalai Lama is like this guy in the neighborhood. Yeah. And then that was a thing, if my memory serves, where we just married those two ideas. Yeah. And it was like, oh, this is great. Because neither of them on their own were like, yeah, it's okay. It's okay. But then putting those two things together, making this bigger piece, like created this whole cool thing.
Yeah, I mean, that was like the magic of your show. It would make such a crazy turn and somehow it like made perfect sense and no sense at all. It was just such a sweet like coming together.
Yeah, I'll have... I think I didn't have that many contributions to that sketch, but I think mine was the idea that he kills the guy.
Yeah.
I think there was, and I have another funny story, anecdote. So the folks that directed that episode, that bit were, these great directors, Jonathan Dayton and Valerie Ferris. They're married, Dayton and Ferris, and they've done a bunch of cool videos and they're awesome. And they had an in with, oh, who was it? Flava Flav. Because we wanted to get a real rap star for the rap battle. And so we went out, we reached out to Flava Flav, but he wanted to win the rap battle. And we're like, no, it's a comedy sketch. So the idea is that the Dalai Lama wins is a better rapper. No, I can't do that, man. I have to win. Like, no, that's not how it works. And so we didn't get him ultimately because he wouldn't do it.
That is amazing.
Yeah,
wow.
It's a little nugget, trivia nugget.
That's beautiful. I love it. Great. All right, let's do one more. You might have some fun with this one. This is from Julian. I keep seeing things in the news about mysterious monoliths appearing in the desert, and the government pretty much admitted that UFOs are real. Do you have an apocalypse plan?
Well, I don't know if the monoliths in Nevada are signs of an impending apocalypse, I mean, it's just it's like this crop circles thing, right? Somebody figured it out and covered their tracks and, you know, now we're talking about it. Maybe it's an art piece, man. And UFOs, I mean, aliens are not going to be the cause of an apocalypse. We're in a very, 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 very slow yet absolutely for real apocalypse in real time. It's just happening slowly. Apocalypse doesn't necessarily mean a bunch of fireballs come descend on planet Earth and 7 seconds we're wiped out. No, an apocalypse, we're going through the apocalypse right now in real time, very slowly. My plan is to go out on tour, sell some merch, and then just invest in fresh water, you know?
That's a very smart plan. So what's that website? Because I know you love self-promotion. What's a website where people can find tickets to this tour that you're about to go on?
So go to officialdavidcross.com. And I send out newsletters and stuff, and that will always have like pre-sale information and discount things and a full calendar of where I'll be. And the name of the tour, as you said, is The End of the Beginning of the End. And that will start in, I want to say, mid-September of this year. And I always add dates. So if your town isn't on there, you can certainly write in and say, hey, how come you're not coming to, you know, Tampa Bay? And I'll say, because Tampa Bay sucks and I'm not going back. You know, any other place that's not in Florida, let me know. But I will be adding dates. So you won't see a lot of Canadian dates on, but I will do a whole run of Canada. I'll do Europe and all that. And those will probably come in the new year. And so that I have the information for that. The Central Park show, August 8th, David Cross and Super Pals. That'll be a big, awesome, fun show. And also the Umbrella Academy, August 8th, the same night. I'm in season 4, the last season. And that was a lot of fun. That was just a blast to do and a really cool thing to be a part of. I'm so happy. And I'm excited as a fan of the show to find out. I mean, I know spoilers for my own thing, but I try to remain as, ignorant as possible to what everything else that was happening outside of my character's arc, because I'm a huge fan of the show. So those are the things coming up. You got tour, August 8th, Central Park show, and Umbrella Academy, also August 8th. So go, officialdavidcross.com. And then my podcast, Senses Working Overtime with David Cross, and I guess wherever podcasts are sold.
I will encourage people to do all those things. Definitely listen to podcasts. It's awesome. And what about your energy drink? You haven't mentioned your energy drink.
My energy drink?
I don't know. It just seemed like an idea.
I've started doing ads on the podcast, so I thought maybe that was something that I forgot. Yeah.
Awesome. Hey, David, thank you so much for doing this. It's always so great talking to you.
Well, thank you, man. This is fun.